Hello and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio. This is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. On today's show, we're picking up part two with Jackson Morehead, who was the former security chief at the Scientology's international base in San Jacinto, California. Jackson, when you think of Int Base, what are your primary concerns as security chief?
Well, my first and daily one was to provide a safe and distraction-free environment for the base staff to work in. Our security measures, either equipment or procedures, were established based off of real threats that we defined as real threats. And so therefore, that's how base security became established to what it is today. And even more so in that we actually had two instances of where lives were seriously threatened. One was there was this drill that was done by Marty, was established by Marty, and it was directed by Dave, I eventually found out, because he wanted to put base security to the test to see if we meant business or not, if we were truly, truly a good protecting force for that property. So Marty hired these PIs to come out at night and try to penetrate our perimeter and overcome security. The first time it was done, they were successful in that both the north side and the south side perimeters were breached. People made it through our security system undetected, and it was a big failure. I was surprised I didn't get removed from my job from post as security chief, but it was more or less used to I was seriously belittled, and you know, I'm a schmuck, and you name it, man. It was amazing.
Oh, I could imagine.
So that, as a result, heightened my concern for not only to be self-protective of my job, but also put me in a new realm of I need to really mean business when it comes to base security. So everything and a regular response to an alarm became, you know, like a fire you would send to a dumpster fire. Instead of sending one engine, I would send 10 engines, you know, just as an example. So to every alarm, I would not just have one guard, but I would send two guards, you know, and that was the result of like that drill. I would change procedures and work hard to make sure this never gets repeated again and have a serious approach, not only mentally, but demonstrate it physically that I was serious about security. So the second time round happened a couple of years later. Marty organized another set of PIs to come through, and this time I almost killed somebody. And I was of the mental resolve that my finger was on the trigger, safety was off. Two shots to the chest, one to the head. I'll never forget that moment in my life where you're singing that in your head to yourself, two to the chest, one to the head, two to the chest, one to the head.
And what happened?
I had this guy in my sights. There was an alarm up on the north side of the property, up by the villas, and it wasn't a fence shaker. It was an underground microphone picking up footsteps, and the lights were turned on. A guard was sent. Sure enough, visual confirmation occurred. You know, basically, there were three people outside of our fence. Holy smokes. They're up by the village.
The intruders.
Yeah. They're not yet truly intruders. They're trespassers. Intruders is people who have come over the fence. Excuse me. So these guys kept coming and coming and kept coming closer towards the fence against our directive to stop your trespassing. Please leave the property now. Repeated over and over to them, and they refused. So the closer they got, the more of a threat it was, and I'll never forget being out there. Me and three other guards were out there, and I was the one who had the gun drawn. I was the security chief. The buck stops here. This isn't going to get any worse. The guy was about 20 feet away from me. He was holding out a piece of paper, and I was not concerned about what was on the paper. He just kept approaching, and I told him one last time, one more step, I am going to shoot you. I just told him that. It wasn't loud and commanding. I got down to that, you know, matter of fact statement. You know, I was once going, stop, you're trespassing, stop, you're trespassing, please leave the property. It went down to, you take one more step, pal, I'm going to shoot you. And that's what it was. I was of the mentally prepared to put two in the chest and one in the head. But I stopped myself at the head. It's like, I can't kill this guy. I'll two in the chest and then blow his knees out. That's what I was going to do, because I wanted at least to be able to talk to the guy afterwards.
What happens? What breaks? Literally within seconds.
He was holding out that piece of paper, and I saw Marty on it. And then I was like, what's this? So I had him drop the paper back up, and then I went and got the piece of paper, and it was the piece of paper that Marty had set up that these guys give us to show that it was a drill. So if we ended up getting the piece of paper in our hand, things were okay. So that's what happened.
So someone almost got shot and killed of a drill.
Yep. I'll never forget the look on Warren McShane's face when I'm standing there telling him the story, when Marty and Warren are there, and Warren was like, holy smokes. They didn't realize it could go that far. But it was proof to COB that and I know that everybody was happy, you know, because I was given a quote, a well done, that we meant business, and Dave now had the sense of security to know that our guards would go to the extreme ends to protect him and the property. But I know it was mostly just about him. That mindset of two to the chest, one to the head, that was so ingrained in my head that all of our handguns were loaded with two hollow points as the first two shots and one round head as the third shot. So the two in the chest were an effort to stop. The third in the head was to take them out. So I just wanted to complete that earlier concept of where I was mentally, knowing that my gun was loaded in such a way to support my mental choice to two to the chest, one to the head.
Thank God the people testing you weren't killed.
Right. Now, take that mentality, the mental state of frame of mind that I was in, and that's the level in which everything was approached security-wise. There was always an ultimatum, and there was a serious approach and attitude addressed to every problem that we were addressing, such as the lighting, the type of perimeter fence that was going to be put in, you know, how it was going to be controlled, the effectiveness of it, et cetera. And you were just starting to mention about blows. Well, that same mentality would be applied to not two to the chest, one to the head, but the importance, the level of concern. Let's make sure that we turn every leaf over here. What's another aspect we can look at this? How else can we make sure that we're going to find somebody? When somebody blows, what's the first thing that we ultimately need to do? You know, let's get that documented. Let's get everything in place so we can start it right away, you know. And so you were starting to talk about blows. That tripped open a whole new other aspect of my job, which was to find people.
No, and I'm glad we finished up on the scenario, because that drill where you almost shoot the PI, that's illustrative of the intensity you bring to everything. And I'm glad you said it, because it shows the intensity that Scientology uses to capture Sea Org members who escape or blow.
Well, yes, particularly at the Int base. It didn't filter down to the rest of the lower organizations. It started at the international base, the headquarters, the head of the snake, you name it. That's basically where it started.
Yeah, and this is curious to me, Jackson. You know, in corporate life, someone wants to quit or they're fired. They're shown the door. Mm-hmm. Okay, leave. Mm-hmm. Here's your severance pay. Sign this non-disclosure. You're gone. Doesn't it ever occur to the Church of Scientology that if a Sea Org member wants to escape, I mean, that there's some out point that it's something wrong if somebody wants to leave? Why aren't they allowed to just leave?
Well, see, you kind of bring back a memory of a conversation I had with Shelley once about that very thing. Eric and his wife Johnson, and used to be ASI staff members, Author Services Incorporated. They had their troubles, and they ended up being sent to the Int base. You know, here's a non-quote-unquote Sea Org corporate Scientology CSI-connected organization. Somebody gets in trouble, and then they get pulled from ASI and busted to gold.
Now, just to help our listeners, ASI is Author Services International. It's a for-profit part of the Church of Spiritual Technology.
That's right.
And
supposedly not of Sea Org members, and they don't fall under the policies and procedures of the Sea Org. Well, somebody gets busted in ASI, they get sent to the Int Base.
Now, I don't know if this is correct, but people who work at Author Services International, my understanding, and I could be wrong, is that they are Sea Org members, but they're on a leave of absence from the Sea Organization.
Whatever, Jeff.
It's a fiction.
It is a fiction.
Yes. Okay, so these two people from Author Services International are busted and sent to Int Base.
Yeah, and I had this conversation with Shelley once, long after Eric, and I forget his wife's name, handling, and they eventually left and went down to San Diego to spend the rest of their life with their family. I got a call at the main booth one day from somebody that which they were applying for a job at, and they just were doing where you put on your job application and can we contact your previous employer. Well, that previous employer number that's given out is the security main booth number, and it's a direct outside line, unfiltered through any of the it's a direct outside line from the base to the outside world. And I got this call. I answered it. This is blah, blah. I forget who it was. And I was just checking on the previous employment for Eric and his wife. And I basically told them that, yeah, they were fine, except that they had an attendance issue. Because I remember thinking at the time that it wasn't fair that they, you know, put me through all this havoc. So I was being honest and saying, yeah, they had an attendance issue. Well, they blew from the Int Base, and subsequently I spent a better part of a year watching them every day. So that's why I told them that. And, hopefully, I don't know if that resulted in them getting the job or not, but I told Shelley that. I hung the phone up and then called her to let her know, because she and I had that relationship that if certain people were ever come up again, to call her directly. So in Eric's case, that I was supposed to call her. So I called her and let her know what happened, and then she got upset and said, come up and see me now. So I went up there and saw her and Dave. And
so you have to see David Miscavige and his wife, Shelley Miscavige.
Yeah, I was called up to their office, and Shelley brought me into the office, and I explained to Dave and her what happened, and Dave just gave me that disgusting look, and then he left the room. And Shelley goes, listen, you know, the only thing we're interested in is people's continuation in Scientology. You know, this whole freeloader debt thing is a facade. We don't care about their money. It's a control factor. It's keeping them in line to make sure they continue in Scientology. That's the word
really?
That came out of Shelley's mouth. And it's not about the money. The freeloader debt, that's the first thing set in my mind where I eventually left. I refused to pay my freeloader debt, and I was very verbalized about that out the door, although on the way out the door, that I will never pay my freeloader debt. But the words came out of her mouth that the concern is not the, you know, freeloader debt. Freeloader debt is just used to keep them in check. The real issue is that they are allowed to continue to live a good life, and they continue in Scientology.
Now, that is amazing statement. So Shelley Miscavige tells you that the purpose of the freeloader debt is not the money.
Yeah.
And I can understand that, because the church has at least $1.5 billion that we know about. But it's actually to keep control of you.
Keep them in Jackson, check, yeah.
Yeah, keep – Jackson, one of the perennial complaints forever about the Church of Scientology is they will never let you go.
Right.
Even if you want to leave, they will keep mailing you piles of junk mail, phoning you, trying to recover you. But especially if you're Int Base Sea Org,
yeah,
they really want to keep you.
Oh, there's a whole level, another – it's the next level of the next level. You know, Kirsten, who's now known as Kirsten Catano at the time, is Kirsten Jerry or whatever she was married to at the time. That was the majority of her job, was keeping track of anybody who had left, keeping tabs on what they're up to, where they're at, who they're in touch with, and all that. And for OSA to say that they don't do that is hogwash.
So Kirsten Catano, who's now the Office of Special Affairs Investigation Chief, I think.
Yeah.
Some title like that.
I guarantee you she's no longer on post, but okay.
Well, maybe she's an RPF. I don't know.
I don't know.
But But the point is, when she was at the Int Base, she kept tabs on former
Kirsten
Int Base
members. For the majority of the time, Kirsten was never at the Int Base. She was the Int Base relations down in OSA. She's the one I called to get dirty deeds taken care of.
Okay, thank you for the correcting. It's hard to – when you have an intelligence operation,
yeah,
like Church of Scientology, you got to kind of follow the bouncing ball.
Yeah.
So they kept tabs on people who left. We know now from court records that David Miscavige spent 25 years and $12 million of tax-exempt parishioner money to track Pat Broker.
Oh, Jesus. Pat Broker is just one of them. I never was in on that level of security tracking, but there was – yeah, there you go. That's a good example.
So Shelley tells you that the purpose is to control and make them continue in Scientology.
Her highlight, now, just to clarify, Jeff, her highlight was not the control statement. It was to basically, you know, as a Scientologist, you know it does so much good. It's helped you do so much good. It would be foolish to not think that to help continue offering Scientology to them because it makes them better as a better person, you see? So that was more – when Dave left, Shelley kind of gave me – she – you know, where you move your hand from the top of your face down below, you know, the smile turns into a serious look. Well, that's basically what she turned into when Dave left is like, now listen.
Hmm.
The real effort here is basically we want to know that people are doing good. They're not attacking the church. And, you know, the freeloader debt, that's just all to keep people in check. We don't want the money. We're not concerned about the money. You know, and I even remember her saying that they'll never pay it. I mean, we're sewer members. We don't have that kind of cash. And you know, they're never going to have that kind of money. So it just keeps them in check. The bigger the number, the harder it is. It's like from a person who used to cut the lawns who then blew and left, you know, you may give them a $40,000 freeloader debt. To them, that's a lot of money. Well, then me as the security chief, you know, mine may be bumped up to $200,000. And somebody who is, you know, like if Mark, you know, when Marty left, his is probably going to be in the millions. You see the different levels of freeloader debt that's going to
be. So it's almost like a form of psychological warfare. And I'll tell you that my wife, Karen, she had as a class 12 case supervisor trained by Aaron Hubbard on the Apollo. When she routed out of the Sea Org in 1990, she was given a $90,000 freeloader debt. And in order to stay in the good graces of the church, she had to pay it.
Well, yeah.
I mean,
and
she
exactly.
had to pay it.
And you, it's to now that freeloader debt would be the only way it really panned out is if the person then would like, okay, they would follow suit. They would end up paying it. And no matter what the price tag was, I mean, I'll never forget mine when I was handed mine and I saw all my sec checking that I got. The RTC sec checker was listed as being at the flag comparable to flags. Class 12 rates, the highest trained auditor in Scientology. Average tech checker in RTC was considered at that rate.
$1,000 an hour.
As opposed to a class 4 auditor would be $200 an hour, you know.
How much was your freeloader bill?
Oh, $139,000, something like that. If I looked, I could pull it out, but it's 100.
Like,
yeah, Jesus. Even right now, I got an ability to make that money to $139,000. Yeah.
But you were making like $50 a week, some weeks half pay, some weeks quarter pay, and you're supposed to pay $139,000. Even though they don't need the money,
no.
The Church of Scientology will take it if they can get it.
Well, my point of saying this freeloader debt thing is that was a classic turning point for me of my view of dealing with people who had left is we were bringing them back to help them. I would chase them down. I would, you know, the whole effort was basically to get them back so we can help them. Now, the conflict that entered my world was when they would be brought back. Yeah, they would get auditing. I would never see what went on behind the doors, but closed doors between them and the auditor or sec checker. But I would see the KRs. You know, I'd get copies of the reports and everything. But I was sheltered from the hands-on handling that was being done on the people. But I was still always left with the impression that we are helping them. We are helping them. We are helping them. You know, it's for their good cause. I'm here to help them. But I was I had them under 24-hour watch. Yeah.
Jackson, what percentage of people who blew did you recover?
95 to 97% of the people. There was very few people. Like Jeff Walker, an example. He was somehow so well versed in knowing what the effort was going to occur. He countered the effort that when he blew, which is a humorous story in its own. When he blew, he came back with sheriff deputies to collect his own personal belongings.
And then what? That's game over for you guys.
Yeah, and at that point, yeah. You know, we let Jeff go about his way. Go ahead.
Oh, can you walk us through the anatomy of a blow? You're
okay,
at
well, I'll
base.
Tell you Jeff's as an example.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm sitting in the old main booth one day. It was a sunny afternoon, and I'm just doing my thing, and the phone rings. I answer it. Hello. And he goes, yes. And Jeff, in his New Zealand accent, he goes, hiya, Jackson. This is Jeff. I've blown the base. I've gone out to D with a FCCI at flag numerous times, and I will not be returning to the base. And he said it so matter of fact that I thought it was a drill. First thing kicked in my mind, here I am being tested. So I said, okay, Jeff, where are you at? And he goes, I'm not going to get into those specifics, Jackson, but I'm just giving you the respect to let you know that I've blown. I've gone out to D with an FCCI, and I will not be returning. I was like, okay, thanks, Jeff. And hung up. And I thought, I sat there for a second thinking, wow, I wonder what I'm supposed to do now. Well, I better call somebody who's going to want to know. So the first thing I thought it was Mark Yeager. So I call Mark Yeager's number, and Carol, his assistant, answers the phone, Carol Burke. And, you know, she's another precious soul, and I'll never forget her English accent. And I say, yes, sir, I just was calling to let you know that I just got a phone call from Jeff Walker, who was informing me that he went out to D with an FCCI, and he will not be returning to the base.
Now, explain that term, that he went out to where?
He went out to D. He basically
out to D.
He basically he did the hippity dippity with a public, a high paying public of all people, not just
so Jeff
a fellow
Walker.
Seer, remember, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, Jeff Walker's a class 12, correct?
Yeah, he was senior CS Int at the time.
Okay, so the senior case supervisor international has a sexual affair with a public member of the Church of Scientology.
That's correct, a high-paying public.
My gosh. And then he calls you in a gentlemanly way to inform you that he went out to D and he will not be returning to the base.
That's correct. So and you, I thought it was just I was being tested. I couldn't believe it. I thought it was, you know, not that I thought it was a joke. It just I thought that, hey, well, okay. So
yeah, well, yeah.
I call Carol and I basically inform her the same thing. Okay, sir. And she hangs up. She was a little, you know, shocked by what I had to tell her. And then 5 minutes later, I get a phone call from Yeager on the speaker box. And okay, Jackson, tell me exactly what happened. And then it was then that I realized that this was no joke. Yes, sir.
No.
Jeff Walker called and said that he went out to D with an FCCI and he will not be returning. Where was he? Where was he? You know, it was just turned in. And therein was the first most major search for somebody that ever occurred in the history of my blows. Of
well, what happened?
Hundreds
what,
of
what
people. Oh, Jesus. We probably spent 2 to 3 weeks every day, all day long, looking for Jeff Walker. Every motel and hotel within 100 miles of the base was somehow or another either contacted or surveilled. Bus stations, we had packs of staff in cars and bikes going from town to town. We'd go out to Palm Springs, just searching and hunting for Jeff Walker. We had no information, nothing to work off of, so we developed our own procedures and tried to figure out where the heck this guy was. And that's, you know, that's where I learned to eat on the road, because we were never given any money to eat. And that's how I figured out how to get a free hamburger out of an AMPM after starving all day long. But, from all over L.A., Orange County, San Diego, Riverside County, Palm Springs, Arizona, we just kept trying all these places to find Jeff.
So no expenses spared in searching for Jeff.
Yeah, there was no statement directly as that, but it was obvious that no expense paid in terms of it took as many SEER members as we felt necessary to get on the road and look for Jeff Walker.
Now, how do you, when they send you on the road, you have no cash. You don't have a company credit card?
Nope.
So how do you get a free hamburger?
Out of your own, okay, here's a funny story. Out of necessity, you tend to figure out survivability issues. And in this case, I needed to eat. I was starving. And over the course of probably into my second or third day out. Now, this doesn't mean that I never ate, because sometimes I come back to the base and that's when I would gorge myself. But being out on the road for 24 hours or more, you start trying to figure out how am I going to eat. So I was sitting near an AMPM once, and I realized, the food in there has this time stamp on it, this little sticker that shows its expiration time on it. And once it's hit that time, they can no longer serve it. It's like when milk goes bad, you can't serve it. You know, it goes beyond its date.
Sure.
Well, those things sit under the heat lamp so long, they have to throw them out. Well, I'd go in there and talk to the guy into giving them to me, since he can't sell them, and he would gladly give me whatever was left. And I would get two or three burgers or a couple of hot dogs that were, nicely bronzed by the heat lamps, and I would grab condiments to block the flavor, and oh my god, it was the best tasting thing. I was like having a lobster and filet mignon with
If you're starving, yeah. I understand. I've been out on the road many times late at night, and
that's how I ate on the road at my AMPMs. I'd always find the AMPMs and always I'd walk in and go check the timestamp on it, and that way I knew when I needed to come back to eat. Isn't that amazing? Can you go figure?
I remember one time I flew to Amsterdam, and it was really late at night, and I was starving. I hadn't eaten on the plane, and the only thing that was open was a Burger King in Amsterdam.
Well,
and they were getting ready to close, and I was able to get some cold hamburgers out of them, and I was starving. So no, when you're starving, you'll eat whatever you can get. But back to the blow drills. People have described how the church will go through life history folders, find relatives, go to bus stations, go to airports.
Now, that whole procedure was brought about. See, at the time, I was in charge. There was a flood event that happened at the base that prompted this whole regimented drilling procedure be implemented upon the crew, where I had to develop drill patterns for fire, flood, earthquake, and security situations that would happen. So in the event of an earthquake, what are the staff to do? I had to develop the procedures that the staff were to go and put the measures into place, so when the event did happen, if it did happen, the staff knew what to do. So that extended into, because I was so heavily involved in that, when I had a problem, there was a drill attached to it. A drill being defined as the standard procedure and process one would do to produce a positive result. And, to mitigate an incident. So in this case, staff blowing, there was such a long period of time of we didn't really know what to do. We randomly did various efforts. I developed the procedures of going through people's personal belongings, pulling information from them, finding out their family history, who their family contacts are, the phone numbers, what credit cards they have, any and all information related down, even down to how they tied their shoes and how, the cut of their jib. I got those details about every person. And, we would then utilize that information to track them down, such as a credit card number. I contact Kirsten. I had to get a purchase order approved, an emergency purchase order approved to pay for a PI running someone's license plate or credit card, and OSA would then track their hourly use of the credit card. So, and you got to realize back in the day too, we were taking advantage of personal security violations in that there were not a lot of procedures in place at time yet in society. So you can call up an airport and go, yeah, I'm the brother of Jeff Walker, and I'm supposed to be meeting him at the airport, and yada, he hasn't shown up yet. Can you check his flight? And they would gladly check their flight. So we would take advantage of that, from the banks to credit card information, and we would end up being supplied with all this useful information.
And the fact that the Sea Org member wanted to escape and get the hell out, that's incidental to your concerns to recover him.
Mine was basically complying to an order. I wasn't doing it out of personal interest or entertainment. I was doing it to comply to an order to get that person back.
So that you – because if you didn't comply to orders, you would be RPF.
I had severe consequences. So the motivation was high and hard, my friend. It was – believe me, Jeff, I can't state it enough, the amount of mental stress. Oh, my God. The amount of mental stress that I would be forced into in a drill, in getting somebody back, just to be able to get them back. Compliance to that. I could show them here they are. They're back at the base. Whew.
Yeah, and what's interesting is I'm going to interview some people in the near future who were on the other side of you, who were escaping.
We're souls.
Claire Headley has described her blow. Mark Headley is very dramatic to be on the other side of that, where you have a multi-billion dollar church after you.
Jeff, I've actually taken the time to call a few of the people that I kind of live with this every day. I haven't been able to talk to everybody, but I've called a few of the people that just ring strong memories in my mind and completely apologize to them. It's like, it's kind of like where I realized the feeling that I have about for having chased all these souls down is like the guard in a Nazi camp. I can only compare it to that you think you're doing good, only that when everything comes out of the wash, you were there for, and I don't like using the word Nazi, but in terms of the bone-shattering reality that you get woken up to, that's what it felt like. Is like I was the executor of this demon's directives, and I thought I was doing good. I mean
– No, and people do leave the church, and they do want to – they want to make amends, apologize. It's very cathartic and necessary. Look, I've been asked by several journalists, is the Church of Scientology a business or is it a religion? and I say, well, wait a minute. There's an intermediate category called cult.
It's neither one, Jeff. It's David Miscavige's playground is what it is.
well, no, but follow me, Jackson. I understand that Dave Miscavige runs it, but what I'm saying is the reason the word cult exists, religious cult exists, is to describe something.
Yeah, that's right.
That one is built around, it's a cult of personality. Right. First it was L. Ron Hubbard's, now it's David Miscavige's cult of personality. But what you're describing is this isolation, mental control, coercion, even torture. And that's not too strong of a word for RPF. Not at all. When you know when that kind of mental intensity, where you're a prisoner in your own mind, but literally a prisoner in the Sierra, where you may not leave, you cannot leave. If you leave, you'll be. And this is mind-boggling for anyone who hasn't been around the church to realize. The Church of Scientology, especially Office of Special Affairs and the Sierra, they think they're law enforcement.
Right.
They think they have these rights to lock people up.
Oh my God.
To interrogate.
That's a.
They don't.
Yeah, you hit upon a nail. My God, Jeff, that was another conscious realization too. Is that when I would go through people's personal belongings, I used to question whether I had the right to do this or not. But that was resolved by OSA and our church attorneys that because it's on the property that we own, it's ours.
Well, no, and I take your point. Look.
And that gave us carte blanche to go through and basically have the right into anybody's personal belongings at any given time.
Well, the Catholic Church does it.
Yeah.
Businesses do it. When I had an office in a business, they had the right to search my property that was on their property.
Yeah.
That is understood. What I'm saying, no, is when you exceed the basic law and you get into false imprisonment.
Yeah.
Illegal search and seizure, interrogation, lockdown, held against will.
Yeah.
That's where the church becomes cultic. Most dramatically in the Lisa McPherson death, where they lock her up for 17 days and she dies.
Yeah.
I mean, this is why it's called a cult, because their behavior is often illegal.
Right.
Very often unconscionable, violating the societal norms, and not even – it's inhumane.
That's right. But see, at the time, Jeff, that Lisa McPherson is over there at Flag being – you know, looked after and going through a type 3 handling, they're not conscious of what they're doing.
Well, no, not at
all.
In
that regard. And then she dies. It's like, holy shit. Excuse my French.
No.
This woman died on her watch.
Well, no, that's the whole point of a cult is being in it. It is mind control, coercion, stress, duress. And you don't realize you're in the cult until you leave. And then you go, oh my God, what was I doing in there? What was I thinking?
Exactly.
So, and the good thing, Jackson, and I do appreciate your candor, and it is brutal. But again, this is one reason I do Surviving Scientology Radio, to talk to people who were there. You could bare your soul. It allows people listening who are still in the church to say, you know what, this is wrong. I'm leaving.
And you know what, Jeff? On that note, I have to stressfully state that that attitude and mentality has not changed one iota. That's what's so predictable about the church, is that once these things are in place and working for them, it doesn't change. The only way it does change, and it by force of hand, by doing what is being spoken about right now, letting people become aware of the wrongdoings, you wake up and go, holy smoke, and trying to communicate and get the word out there that's what goes on, and it forces the, just by that nature, Dave's hand to change things, but he changes it in a way that still gets him what he wants. It's like, how come Heber Jentz and how come Jaeger and Guillaume and all these people, how can they still be there? Well, they're there because Dave changed his tactics. You know, the abortions stopped. I guarantee you that the abortions in the church have stopped simply because of the fact that the church attorneys, and this is, again, I'm not there, I wasn't there, but I will tell you this as a very educated guess, that conversation occurred. The church attorneys told Dave, you have to stop this, and something needs to be done, change your ways. Okay, good. The new handling is, someone gets pregnant, they're routed out, no questions, give them money, pat them on the back, you know, pet them, out they go. They're no longer kept there.
And that you are correct, Jackson. The church does respond to public pressure, which is why people like you and I.
Exposure of the truth, that's right. And it pisses Dave off to no end. Believe me. Oh, my God. I've witnessed that. Oh, my God. I can only imagine.
But do you have an example, a concrete example of where he's reacted to something?
Oh, Jesus. Yeah, well, just – here's just one off the top of my head. There was this full-size seagoing container. You know the containers you see on these big ships that cross?
Overseas shipping containers. Yeah.
Okay. We had a number of those that stored SEMO International data files. Basically, their written documentation of their history, all the missions that they did, the programs they wrote, LRH, whatever. Now, the section of the property out by OGH where they were set up and storing all that information, we were cleaning up and we're relocating and basically getting rid of those containers, taking all their contents and putting them in proper storage facilities. Well, there was a project that Andre Tavioian was mixed up with. He was responsible for doing the estates part of it, looking after getting the physical area cleaned up and construction going and built out. And then there was people assigned as a project specifically to get those containers emptied and what to do with all those particular files. So one Saturday, the trucks showed up to haul these containers away, and all Andre was interested in was getting the containers out of there. He wasn't concerned about their contents. Well, part of the written-out project orders that these two girls, Jean Tomasovic and Chris Hanlon, were in charge of doing and handling the contents was security was with the security check, basically inspecting containers before they were physically moved off the property. Well, that was going on up to a certain point where Andre himself, who was in charge of the project of basically bringing in earth movers and dealing with the ground in which those containers sat. And the coordination between him and Chris and Gene, he was like, these containers are still here. They're supposed to be gone by two. He was like, let's get them moved. So the truck showed up. One of them was still full of information, front to back, top to bottom. And off these containers were being hauled back to Los Angeles down to the harbor. And so I get this report this Saturday afternoon that Jean was like, she's all sheepish and she knows how much trouble she's going to get into by saying this. But if she didn't say anything, she would get in worse trouble when it later discovered. So she comes up all sheepishly, Jackson, she's crying her eyes out. I sent a container off the property full of C1. Dan was like, oh my God, severe out security, right? It's like the Fed sending out the goods of detailed documentation. Anyways, so I'm having this heated discussion with Gene and Chris out behind the Massacre Canyon in the dining facilities, and here comes Dave and Shelley riding on their back after on their bike back up to the villas after lunch, and Dave drives by with Shelley on the back. They then swing back around and come up and stop and ask me what's up, and I was like, well, sir, unfortunately, I have to tell you is that a container full of C1 data files have been shipped off the property and it's on its way down to Long Beach. And he was like, he just sits there and goes, really? And I said, yes, sir, but I've got this in place and I'm doing this and I'm doing that. And he goes, okay, get back to me when this is taken care of. So I was like, wow, I didn't get chewed out. I mean, you literally do have that thought. It's like, wow, I didn't get chewed out or yelled at right then and there. And the fact that he was like, okay, sounds like the situation is in good hands, when he gives you that demeanor feeling, you feel, okay, good. I'm still here. I'm still standing. I got to keep going and get this handled. So, okay, that was at about 12:45. By 1 o'clock, I get a phone call from Shelley. You need to come up to my office. I go up there, yeah, and I'm thinking, okay, well, this isn't because she wants to talk about, the flowers planted out in front of her office. This is obviously having to do with the container thing. So I get up there. Chris and Gene get called up there. Andre gets called up there. Jim Mortling gets called up there. Steve Willett gets called. All these people that have anything to do with this project get called up to this office. And we are,
Jackson, there's a container load of secret data.
Church
secret data.
On its way.
It's going down
to Long Beach.
Port.
That's right.
And so this is turning into a big flap.
Yes. And somehow,
what happens?
Somehow, some way, by the time I got to that meeting, I already had it confirmed that that container had been turned around and was on its way back to the property. So I walk in the office. I was the first one there. I knew all these other people were coming because I was told that, because that was, again, part of security, saying if anybody wanted somebody found, the main booth was given a call and a guard was sent to go find them. So all these people were being asked for. We had to get them, and I was the first one there. I walk in, and there's Dave, there's Marty, there's Ray Midoff, and there's Mark Yeager. It doesn't get any higher in terms of the church executives.
Yeah, all the big guys.
The top brass are sitting in this small office, and there's two desks with an aisle down the middle back to a wall, and Dave sitting on the corner of a desk, and it was imposing. All the brass on their shoulders, you name it. Okay, so, and Shelley's in there. Yeah, and here's Jackson walking in. So Dave asks for all the specifics. I give him a whole verbalized rundown, and he says, motherfucker, Jackson. He just goes in, and he wasn't really yelling. It was just like having a conversation, but, obviously an undertone of an important one. I said,
yeah,
this,
very intense.
This is the worst out security in the history of Scientology. You realize you're responsible for that, right? Yes, sir. I'm the security chief. It is my job. And he said this, and he just kept shaking his head. This is the worst out security in the history of Scientology. And that was a famous phrase of his, in the history of Scientology, because it came up later, because I ran across it later with him. So the kind of, the blood washes out of your system, all feeling and mental stability, and, this lightheadedness sets in. Like you are in a world of shit when those words
because
come out.
It's
of
the worst. It's the worst
out security. And I'm the security chief of the Int Base, so it's the ultimate insult. So
Jackson, look at this thing. Okay. Miscavige is famous for bloviating. So highest ever straight up in vertical international expansion across all sectors and magnitudes, blah, 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 blah. Now, this is the worst ever. And again, in our first hour, we talked about how there's hysteria at the top. So now you're being accused of perpetrating the worst ever out securing the all of Scientology.
That's right. And I'm the security chief.
Oh, so it's your ass.
Oh, completely. Now,
what happens?
Now, okay, at the end of that conversation, he didn't get into any what's going to happen yet. I got the distinct feeling he was waiting for everybody else to show up. So ironically, suddenly these 6 to 8 people start coming in and they start squeezing in the small office and we're all standing shoulder to shoulder. You know, when you stand in a closed quarters and then the door keeps opening and more people come in and it's harder to open up the door.
Yeah,
and the last person's got to squeeze himself through the little gap. Well, that's what it turned out to be. And once we were all in there, Dave starts picking people off and starts going through their own involvement in the whole thing. And you just see every person that has to start answering up. Chris Hanlon, she'll cry on the dime, you know. She'll cry at a bug hitting a windshield. You know, she's very emotional. She was crying her eyes out, trying to explain her thing. And Dave was just contently sitting there listening the whole time, I got to say. He would be the one asking the questions. Nobody else was asking anything, but he just went through one by one.
So is Dave turning the screws on everyone?
Well, he's pulling the information from everybody. And he knows the impact it's having on them all. Because he doesn't go, hey, listen, folks, just relax. All I want is the facts. He doesn't give any precursed directive on that. He knows the impingement that is being had here. He knows the level of which our souls are being rattled, okay? That is very well-established environment. So everybody starts giving their stories. Andre gives his. Willett gives his. Mortland gives his. And I forget exactly what the result. Once he got all the information, he then ends up walking out of the room disgusted. This is the worst out security in the history of Scientology. Now, I was the only one that had a positive result in the fact that I had confirmation that that container was on its way back. So proof that the container didn't fall into evil hands. And in fact, the container did show up 2 hours later, and you know it hadn't been broken into the whole nine yards. So I successfully reversed the thing. That didn't stop other people from still getting in trouble. So Gene and Chris, being on the project in charge of that thing, were assigned lower conditions. They were taken off that mission, that project. You know, so they had to go off and do, you know, make up the damage in the whole nine yards.
Yeah, make up the damage they did to the group. Well, I'm just curious, did they pulp the files? Did they destroy the files?
No, the files weren't destroyed. They were all taken out of the container and put where they were going to be stored. I mean, those are historical files for CIMO, the history of church management, basically.
Oh, I see. Okay, thank you.
But that didn't stop the impact from happening. Now, later in the day, Andre himself, who was in charge of the construction aspect of the project where those containers were, by the end of that day, it was a Reynolds day, huh?
Andre who?
Andre Tabioyan.
Okay, that's what I want to make sure.
Nicest guy in the world. He definitely had an ex-Vietnam mental state about him because he was from Vietnam. Nicest guy in the world, though. So easy to get along with. Really fun to hang out with. Fun, boisterous, you know, just the guy. Was nothing.
Oh, yeah. I'd love to have him on the show.
Oh, yeah.
I would love to have him on the show.
Anybody listening knows Andre. He was definitely an edgy, sharp guy, but he was fun guy at the same time. So Andre and his wife, Mary. Andre had a white pickup truck that he owned, an old Datsun or Toyota. And now every Saturday after base rentals, everybody would take off at 5 o'clock. Everybody would take off, go home, get cleaned up for the day, and come back for dinner that night. So Andre and his wife took off in their pickup truck. And Andre said that he was taking Mary, who worked in the galley. She wasn't part of renovations crew. She was part of the crew that she worked in the galley and basically made up the meals for the crew. So she didn't have for her to show up at the booth at that time of day to say she was leaving would be considered an outness unless you had a valid story attached to it. So there's Mary with Andre. leaving, saying they're going to go home, and then he said, I got to drop Mary off for a doctor's appointment in town. And it was like, oh, okay. That sounded legit enough. Unbeknownst to me, Andre and Mary were blowing. We're taking off at that time. So they took off. And we didn't.
Wow.
We actually didn't really discover that until I think later that night, well after dinner, is to, where's Mary? You know, the galley crew were like, where's Mary? And then it was like, hey, where's Andre? And then lo and behold, we inspect their berthing, and they took their stuff and confirmed that they had actually taken off. So that began another level of blowing, because they blew as a direct result of the intimidation of and the result effect of the effects that Dave gave of this confrontation that he had with us, how much it upset him and how much in trouble we were, and the significance of it. And I mean, that was, you know, I don't.
So what's interesting is that David Miscavige just, I guess you could call it a face ripping SRA, whatever.
Yeah, serious reality adjustment. Yeah. Yeah. That's
yeah. Exactly. So he rattles
everyone's cage.
All of it, everyone. And then you have Andre, an executive, blowing because of
and
that.
And it breaks him. Yeah, it breaks him. And now, here's the other thing is, when Andre got in trouble, he kind of went into this self-defense mode, and he went on, I guess there's no better way of describing it, like a psychotic outbreak where he was just defending himself. I know how to protect myself. He would use that language. You stay away from me. And I remember the concern when the reports got forwarded up the line to RTC is what the handling, what the ongoings were with recovering Andre. Bill Dindu, who was a safe point, a good friend of Andre's, was on the phone with him, and Bill Dindu was at the time a upper management executive and watchdog committee, WDC at the time, said that Andre basically made threats over the phone to stay away, I'll shoot, I'll protect myself. I mean, Andre would say that stuff. He was saying that. Now, if you really knew him, you knew he was just spouting out stuff.
Blowing smoke, yeah.
But you know, we also knew Andre that we didn't know if he would be fully true or not, but the resulting effect was that it was taken as a threat to Dave. That the concern became I had to increase my, you know, security concerns because Dave was concerned that Andre was going to come shoot him.
Take
him out.
Jackson, this is nuts. You have here's how I look at it as an outsider. And I worked in, part of my work for a long time was trailer loads of stuff going, you know, I had to ship to customers and just kind of watch logistics. So you get a trailer leaves the property, it shouldn't leave, you get it turned around. You call the driver, the trucking company, you get the truck turned around. I've had to do that. Not a big deal, right? Turn the truck around, bring the set of doubles back. But this turns into the largest out security in the history of Scientology. People are dealt with harshly. Andre blows, and then it turns into he's going to try to come and kill me, is what David Miscavige is saying.
Well, it gets worse than that. It's better than that, Jeff.
Well, how does it get worse?
Well, the church, in an effort to protect itself and put itself in the right versus the wrong of Andre's kid, it starts being used as a leverage point because Andre wants his son Casavius to come with him.
Oh.
Now, I forget what age Casavius was at the time, but he was part of the kids' ranch out at Happy Valley.
So now Miscavige has Andre's.
He uses it as
son.
It gets used as leverage to Andre. You want your kid, you answer up, you sharpen up, you come back, you know, the whole nine yards.
So they literally are using the child as a hostage of sorts.
Well, yeah, but it gets worse than that, Jeff. It eventually. It was the key point between Andre and the church, Andre, Mary, and the church. You want your son, you need to resolve. You need to come back. So basically the church can come back and get him secured because Andre is a loose cannon at rough seas in the church's eyes, in Dave's eyes. He could create –
understood.
He could, because of his history and what's going on now, he could go public and create a lot of havoc for the church. So an equal amount of effort was in to protect that concern, And that's where his son Kasavius was used as a tool. Now, Kasavius, at that point, he gets put under 24-hour watch, buddied up. At all times, we need to know his location. His life gets turned upside down because of the church's desire to use him as a coin. Excuse me. And Kasavius knows that his dad's gone, but he doesn't understand the importance behind why his life is suddenly being turned upside down.
Jackson, look at the horrible depersonalization. This is something that's always bothered me.
Oh, it gets worse than
calling people coins. People are not coins. They're people. They are not coins.
It went so far as Andre, because he had legal guardianship, that's his son. I mean, that's his father to son.
Yeah.
Andre kept communicating, going to bat, getting his son. The church went so far as getting... Once Kasavius was of whatever required legal age to do so, had Kasavius change his name legally, change his name, and create, quote, his new parental father, which was Dan Probilski. Kasavius, because of what Kasavius goes under nowadays legally as his legal name, is a direct result of that incident of what happened at the base, where Andre blew because of the shakedown Dave gave him and RTC's efforts to protect the church. They went so far as to say, F you, Andre, if you're not going to go say, you know, do what we say, then they protected themselves by using Savius as a coin and went so far as forcing him to change his name legally and assigning and getting legal documentation that Dan Probilski was his legal new legal father.
Now, is it correct that they moved Kasavius out of the country?
Yeah, I wasn't there to witness that, because eventually that's what it came down to. Even to this day, Kasavius is held against meeting up with his father, reuniting with his father, even to this day, and that I've had confirmed. It's freaking shocking.
You know, this is where disconnection, that's the wrong word. It's emotional blackmail.
Yeah, people,
that's all disconnection.
People think all this disconnection, that's as far as, I mean, this every day-to-day disconnection effort by the church, you know, fathers and mothers and sons and sisters can no longer talk to another. No, this is as far as how far the church took matters when they were faced with them, is they would see to it for their own protection, get Kasavius to change his name, so to completely wash any, what am I trying to say, parental influence and control or responsibilities that any parent would have for their child, the church took control of basically that child, got his name changed and assigned him underneath and changed his last name to Probilski under Dan Probilski. Dan Probilski couldn't be the opposite genetically of Kasavius. It's like, oh my God, it's just I'm having a hard time defining and explaining conceptually what the effort went into it, Jeff, but to think that...
No, I understand.
Oh, my God.
The church's power is emotional blackmail, or what we could call takeaway. What the church will do out of spite, revenge, and pure hatred is they will take away anyone you love, anything you love, they will seek to destroy.
That's exactly what they did with Kasavius.
And I got to tell you, I saw it up close and personal when my wife's son Alexander Jens died. They would not let Karen see her son's dead body and kiss him goodbye.
Yep.
And that had to be...
You and I can never define that for what it's like for a mother.
Well,
you know,
no, it's, you know what it is? It's depraved. That's when I saw the depravity of the Church of Scientology and David Miscavige and OSA up close and personal. That was the single most depraved thing I've ever lived through.
Yeah. Oh, man.
And that's when you realize that the church is
evil.
Deadly serious.
That's right.
They're very evil. They're very evil in terms of breaking up families. And really, to me, this is religious terrorism, but it's also fundamentally weakness, because only a coward or a bully would engage in emotional blackmail at that level. You know, that kind of using people, because they ultimately, the church is powerless. It really is powerless.
It totally is powerless. That's right.
Yeah, it's an admission of cowardice and powerlessness. And what I would say to people listening in is, if you're still in the church, you know this goes on. You know it's not right. And the only self-determined action you can leave, the real end phenomena, is for you to maintain your integrity by leaving the Church of Scientology. And the reason people like myself, Jackson, my wife, Mike Rinder, Marty Rathbun, Amy Scobie, you go on down the list, hundreds of people now, over 1,000, speak out, is because the abuse has to stop and the church is incapable of reforming itself.
So much has changed because of those people's efforts, Jeff. So much has changed, you know, from the abortions to, you know, how people leave. I mean, people leave now with support money. I mean, when I was basically somehow managed to maintain my desire and drive and effort to actually leave, I was faced with, okay, we're done with you. There's the door. No money, no nothing, nowhere to go, sleeping on the streets, nowhere. There's the door. You walk out the door. It's like, now what am I going to do?
But Jackson, your freedom is worth so much more,
if
you have to be broke and start over in life. And I know plenty of people who are broke, spent 20, 30 years in the church. They leave, they're broke. Jeff Hawkins, everyone. Marty,
they have to start over. Money. They find them a place to stay. You know, and that stuff that we have collectively, through communicating our stories and relating the truth, the church is like, well, we can't deny it, and they know it, so they're forced to change their hand, and they hide under the cloak of religion, but they do change it, and that's been confirmed from other people that have since left.
And Jackson, we're past our hour mark. I'd like to do a part three, but in concluding, and this is a very shocking, dramatic insight into the church and its leader, David Miscavige, what would you say to people listening who are still in the church?
Well, I've always thought about that, Jeff. I don't know what to tell them because there's nothing that can magically be told to anybody that would suddenly change them on a dime. It's just, with exception to, you have to work on your own perceptions and gather your own information. Stop functioning as a person that takes verbal direction from somebody without you looking on your own. You know, take the information you're given and go look yourself. Look yourself.
Jackson, I appreciate that. Look for yourself. On the next time we meet, I'd like to interview you about the exact chain of events that led you to leave the Church of Scientology.
Oh, okay.
You know, the defining one, because I think people would very much like to hear someone at your level.
Oh, my Lord. Yeah, that was a whole era itself. Okay.
So we'll leave it at there until next time. For Surviving Scientology Radio, this is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Thank you for listening, and as always, we'll be in very good touch.